Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News' weekly series of discussions with policymakers whose decisions affect Nebraskans' lives. And with me today is Senator John Moranti of Gretna. Senator Moranti, welcome. You've been in the legislature. This is your third year.
Great.
And outside of this building, you are the owner of a spectacularly named restaurant.
That's right.
What's that?
Big Fred's Pizza, started by my grandparents, Fred and Rose Bruning, in 1965, so we're 50 years old now. My wife and I started operating it in March of 2013, and we're still going strong.
All right, and I can recommend it. I've been there.
Thank you. It's good to see you.
You're also the chair of the government committee, and in that capacity, this session, you've been pretty busy. You've had a number of high-profile bills come from the committee to the floor, and I want to ask you about those. The most recent one was the winner-take-all electoral vote measure. Can you bring people up to speed on what that would do and why you think it's a good idea?
Sure. Well, right now, Nebraska's electors, how we determine who the next president of the United States is going to be, is one of only two states which allocates their electors the way that we do, which is to say that the winner of the state will get two electoral votes and the winner of each congressional district will get one. I believe that's bad public policy, and I believe that we should embrace the method that is used by the overwhelming majority of states in this country, which is to say that the winner of the state gets all the state's electoral votes.
And why do you think it's bad public policy the way we do it now?
There's a number of reasons. First of all, I think there needs to be consistency in how each state elects the president. I think it's bad public policy to have disparate methods of allocating the electors. So I think that if all of the states chose to embrace Nebraska's system, that would be one thing. But to have us be the anomaly, I believe, is bad public policy. Second, when we base how the president of the United States is elected by congressional districts, congressional districts, as you well know, are drawn by individuals in redistricting processes. Even in the best of circumstances, and as you know, I'm working on an independent redistricting commission so that Nebraska's
right. And I
congressional
want to get to that.
Okay. But even in that circumstance, even if we embraced a system like that, the districts are still going to be drawn by individuals. They will be imperfect. They will at times be arbitrary. And it's just politicized. And we have to do that with our congressional representation. That's how we elect members to Congress. But we don't have to elect a president of the United States with those sorts of biases or politics. We can take that out. Senator McCoy's bill, LB 10, does that, and I think that's better public policy.
Now, it advanced. There was a filibuster against it, but it got the minimum number of votes that it needed to advance, which was 33. And part of the discussion was that this is a measure that is favored by your party, the Republican Party, because Nebraska is, in addition to all the high-sounding political science considerations you just gave, obviously the Republican Party has a registration advantage in this state, and so if you elect on a statewide basis, chances are that the Republicans will get all five electoral votes. That was, to the extent that that played any role in the decision, that helped you get the 33 votes. But on a previous bill, the voter ID, which is also favored nationally by the Republican Party, that did not make it. That fell victim to a filibuster. What was the difference in the dynamics between those two?
Well, the two issues are fundamentally different, and I don't believe that the members of the legislature look at these two issues through a partisan lens. I think if the definition of partisanship is embracing public policy, which is to the detriment of the state but for the betterment of a political party, I don't see a lot of that in the Nebraska state legislature, and I think that's a very good thing. We see Congress broken down with partisanship, people unwilling to work with each other. You don't see that in Lincoln, and I think perhaps that's an indication we need better representatives in Washington, but I don't believe that the motivation by the members of this legislature, whichever ideological side they come from, is motivated by party. I think it is genuinely a public policy question, and I think that's what each member embraces.
Now, you mentioned redistricting, and you would probably agree that while nonpartisanship is generally observed, that every 10 years there's a battle along partisan lines over redistricting. But you have a bill that would change that, so describe that a little bit.
What my bill would do is create an independent redistricting commission, which would be composed of 9 citizens from across the state of Nebraska, which would be selected by the members of the legislature. And what those citizens would do is take a system as defined by state law, use a process, basically an instruction manual that's in statutes. And the instruction manual would be written this year in a time when their partisanship is at a minimum. Emotions are kind of out of the way, where we can look at it analytically and mathematically. And they would draw the maps and send them to the legislature, and the legislature would take action at that time.
So you were involved as a staffer in the last redistricting, which was in 2011. Mm-hmm. And at that time, the executive director of the state Democratic Party essentially suggested that you had a hand in creating the district that you now represent.
Sure.
Is that fair?
It's not an accurate assessment as to why Gretna received and Western Sarpy County received a new legislative district. Gretna and Sarpy County received a new legislative district because Gretna is the fastest growing city in the state of Nebraska, and Sarpy County is the fastest growing county in the state of Nebraska. And when we see the enormous amount of population shifts, as we've seen, there's no way about it. And at the time when redistricting was taking place, Gretna, which as you know sits on about 204th Street in Sarpy County, our state senator lived on 27th Street. If we applied that same standard to the city of Omaha, where we had a district where the state senator lived on 24th Street, but the district went out to 204th Street, no one would think that that's appropriate. We have a compelling desire to have communities of interest within legislative districts, and that's why every single map which was proposed in the state legislature, regardless of the party of who introduced it, placed Gretna in a new legislative district. There just was no way to keep Gretna in, there was no practical way to keep Gretna in the same legislative district, and that's why the new district was moved to Sarpy County.
Okay, and that was the legislative redistricting part mm-hmm. of it. The major controversy in 2011 over partisanship was over the redrawing of the congressional district,
right,
where Western Sarpy County was lumped in with, I'm losing it. Mm-hmm. Remind me what happened.
What happened was basically the sides of Sarpy County, which were in the first and the second district, essentially flipped.
Right.
So previous to the 2011 redistricting, Western Sarpy County, Gretna, Springfield, predominantly rural parts of the county, were in the first congressional district. After the redistricting process, Bellevue was moved into the first congressional district, and Gretna and Springfield was moved into the second.
Okay, and that was widely seen by Democrats as an attempt to help then Congressman Terry and the second congressional district have a more Republican cast to it. I'm wondering, is that something that what is the proper sphere for partisanship and partisan considerations in redistricting, in your view? I mean, we have a nonpartisan legislature, mm-hmm. but obviously Congress is a political animal. Mm-hmm. There's nothing necessarily wrong with that. Is there or is there?
No, I think that to take partisan considerations above and beyond what traditional redistricting principles guide maps to be drawn is not appropriate. And I think that The story of the second congressional district in 2011, one thing that the people who have complained about the maps don't often point out is that the registration largely stayed the same in the second congressional district. The registration advantage was pretty much the same after the redistricting process.
Well, didn't the Republicans gain like 1,500 voters or something like that?
Something out of the 600,000 people in the second congressional district. It was largely the same. It's almost impossible to keep things exactly the same, but it was largely the same statistically.
So is your bill designed to reduce that consideration even farther?
I believe so. What it does is it lays out in the law the traditional redistricting principles which should be guiding the map drawing in the redistricting process. I think it would be an improvement over the system. While I don't believe that the system has been abused to the extent that some have articulated, I do think improvements can be made.
Improvements from the point of view of nonpartisanship and mm-hmm. professionalism. But why is that only good for the legislature and the legislative process and not for the congressional process? I mean, if you were to move on from the legislature and run for Congress, I assume you would be as partisan as the next guy. And so I just don't understand, you know, why one level of representation, it's a great thing that it's nonpartisan, and then the next level, it's a great thing that it's, you know, bare-knuckle partisan.
Well, I do take nonpartisanship very seriously, and if I were ever to advance to the next level, I wouldn't lose that nonpartisan spirit. But I would say that the Independent Redistricting Commission, which is envisioned in my bill, it applies to Congress as well. It's not simply for the drawing of legislative district maps. It includes the drawing of congressional district maps, as well as the Board of Regents, the State Board of Education, the Public Service Commission, and judicial districts. It's really across the board. And when we talked about it in the public hearing, it was Senator Campbell, I think, rightly pointed out that these principles ought to be applied to the political subdivisions in Nebraska, because I think we have a good framework right now, but we ought to be giving them guidance as to how the maps ought to be drawn, because the legislature doesn't have any direct control over that at the present time. But providing some sort of guidance to the political subdivisions, I think, is appropriate.
Okay. So what's the remaining big suspense for you in this legislative session? Not necessarily on these bills, but on anything.
Sure. Well, the governor has outlined a bold strategy to grow Nebraska. His Grow Nebraska plan, which was outlined in his State of the State address, is something that we're going to start working on very shortly. One thing I hear over and over again from the people in Nebraska is that taxes here are too high, and we have to take steps to have serious and meaningful tax relief in the state of Nebraska.
And which involves cutting spending, no?
It does, and in some cases it's not a matter of shrinking the dollars that are being spent or spending less money than we did last year. It's simply a matter of moderating the growth in spending. We have done a very good job over the last 10 years of tightening the belt and balancing the budget without raising taxes. And we had some very difficult economic years. But in those years, they curtailed spending and they didn't raise taxes. And that's why we're in the good fiscal position that we're in today.
Well, but I mean, how do you go on from there if you've done such a great job for the last 10 years and people are still telling you taxes are too high? Mm-hmm. What are we going to do, stop paving roads?
No, I don't think that that's the option. I don't think it's an option of stop having state services or cut taxes. I think the option is in between. We can cut taxes over an extended period of time. It took us a long time to get to the high tax state that we are today, and it's going to take us a long time to get out of it. But it's just a matter of curtailing the amount of growth in spending every single year so that we meet the needs which most of us can agree have to be spent, but at the same time not growing government with new government programs on an annual basis. Simply limiting the increase is all we need to do in the state of Nebraska.
Okay. Well, we'll watch this glacier as it progresses. Mm-hmm. Want to thank Senator John Maranti for coming in. This is Capital Conversations. You can find us on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another discussion next week and hope to see you then.